Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free, 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Oh, wow, we did it again. Another great Friday show lineup. Darren's not even here to take the credit for it, but Darren scheduled us another great lineup today. Second hour, we're going to talk with Douglas Beaumont, former evangelical minister, now Catholic, about sola fide and sola scriptura. What are the intellectual underpinnings of those ideas, and do those have those survived the last 500 years, or is it time to move beyond that? That'll be next hour. This hour, Mary and the modern woman. The modern world, I suppose we could say, presents a sick image of both manhood and womanhood in many ways, and produces a lot of television to try to convince us that those images are not sick. But I do think, if we're honest, we have to admit that the modern world, while it offers a great many opportunities, also produces a great many lives that feel futile and not feel fully human, and certainly not fully happy. So how do we find out what is a healthy image of manhood and womanhood? Today we'll focus on womanhood, and as much as the modern world mocks her, Mary of Nazareth, Mary the mother of Jesus, is just the woman for the job. Mary and the modern woman, our topic. If you have questions or comments in that regard, please give us a call, 888-318-7884. 888-318-7884. Our guest this hour, Dr. Carrie Gress. She has a doctorate in philosophy from the Catholic University of America, and she's a faculty member of Pontifex University. She's the author of Nudging Conversions, A Practical Guide to Bringing Those You Love Back to the Church, Ultimate Makeover, The Transforming Power of Motherhood, and among other things, but her most recent book is The Marian Option, God's Solution to a Civilization in Crisis. Dr. Carrie Gress, thank you for being with us.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here with you this evening.
So, Mary and the Modern Woman, I think most people would say, oh, well, maybe I shouldn't say most people. I really don't know how most people. What I can kind of, I suppose what I mean is certain wise and maybe media savvy heads of our age would say, well, Mary is irrelevant to the life of a modern woman. How do you respond to that?
Yeah, I think that is kind of the general overall feeling. In fact, just even the mere suggestion that women should be like Mary, I think, is really met with either laughter or just incomprehensibility. How is it that we can even model ourselves after Mary in this day and age? And so it's really a challenge. And I think that there's so many tentacles to this issue. But some of the suggestions that I have been reading, especially when I was doing research on the Marian option, was that we just need to change Mary. And, I think that you run into some problems with that. And, first and foremost is, of course, the idea that within Christianity, of course, we get our dignity as women from, Christ offered it through example in the scripture. But by and large, this notion that women are equal to men has stemmed a lot from who Our Lady is and her example, particularly during the medieval times, and then what has come down to us. And so it's a remarkable thing that there's such a backlash against Our Lady, given that she's really the one that has given us dignity in the first place. So I think that it is a complicated issue and one that I've kind of tried to avoid, but I keep running into it. I can only dodge the bullet for so long because it's such a tough issue to talk about.
Yeah, I think it's tough probably in some measure just because it will be met, as you said, with incredulity. Like, are you kidding me? Mary for a modern woman?
Right.
How could that be the case?
Mm-hmm.
So maybe give us an idea how that could be the case. What do we see in Mary that that the modern woman might find as a guide and a help?
Right. Well, the first thing that I think we have to do is really look at our own age with sort of something more of more scrutiny. The one thing that I always get accused of is just suggesting that women need to be doormats or, we need to go back to some sort of very servile position. And I think this is what is always astounding to me is that, I've never suggested anything like that. If I thought that women ought to be doormats, I certainly wouldn't be writing or talking or speaking about it. And it's that, it's our natural reaction. We like to go from one extreme to the other. I mean, Aristotle noticed this, you know, 3,000 years ago, was this idea that our minds, we go from one extreme to the other, and usually there's a lot more in the middle than we're interested in talking about. So I think that's one thing to be aware of. The other thing that has been striking to me is just to recognize that there's a real spirit that we're seeing among women in our age today that I don't think you can see anywhere else historically. It's really unprecedented. And I think it's actually, and I talk about this in my book, The Marrying Option, this idea of an anti-Mary. You know, it's one of these things that hasn't gotten a lot of theological attention up till recently. I've started speaking about it, and I've had different theologians come and tell me, you know, there's nothing theologically wrong with this idea. And in fact, I think it helps us understand what's happening in the culture and why it is that we're not only just seeing, sort of a blasé attitude about Mary, but in fact, we're seeing open hostility towards her and towards the idea of motherhood, towards the idea of having children. And in fact, you know, the culture openly says that children get in the way. And this is one of the reasons why we have to have contraception and abortion, because otherwise our vocation as women is really thwarted. Now, of course, that's, you know, very much a clear line that something has gone awry in the culture, what we haven't seen before.
It does seem a striking feature of the kind of the postmodern scene is the separation of women's interests from children's interests, as if women and children are enemies to one another.
Yeah, and that is the real crux of it, I think, when you make both children the enemy, but also men the enemy. One of the things that I've been working on, a children's book for Marian Consecration, and I've been looking a lot of fairy tales, and one of the things that has jumped out at me strikingly is the role that envy plays in these fairy tales. And I think when you see this pattern of Cinderella, Rapunzel, Sleeping Beauty, Snow White, there's this pattern of envy among women. So I think it's pretty fair to say that this is a deep-rooted vice that women have had for centuries. This is not a new thing. But the difference between jealousy and envy, of course, is jealousy is really just an object of desire that I want, whereas envy says, you know, the person that has what I want is actually either taking away from me or is taking away from my happiness, and therefore they must be destroyed. So this idea, you know, the witch in Sleeping Beauty, who's the fairest, or I guess it's Snow White, who's the fairest of them all, she wants to destroy Snow White because Snow White's taking away from her. Well, we almost are living in this sort of contemporary version of this. And instead of another woman or younger woman wanting to be destroyed, women are actually, because of the fact that we've decided that our equality with men must mean that we are exactly like men, we're now trying to destroy men. And I think that, you know, there's probably not a man alive on the planet today that hasn't had some experience of this. Certainly TV commercials will underscore this, just how stupid men are, and, you know, the wise woman has to come in and help him fix his life, or you know, even figure out how to clean up a kitchen counter. And so it's fascinating to see how these very old ideas are playing out kind of in a new way in our own culture.
But in fairness to that depiction of the man as the bumbling fool, the Homer Simpsonization of maleness, as you said, with Aristotle's idea that the mind tends to extremes, in some ways that seems like a pendulum swing from a maybe 1950s vision of womanhood on television, where she was very, very limited. She was a limited creature, the woman on TV at that time. Would you think that's fair?
Yeah, I think it's interesting that, you know, you go from this pendulum swing to the woman's limited, now it's the man who's limited.
Yeah.
And that direction between the two. But I think also there's, given the fact that we also know that radical feminism really focuses on this idea of gender neutrality and erasing masculinity, calling it, you know, it's evil and vile and has to be gotten rid of, and this is really the root of our problems. Those are also pretty big red flags that certainly something has gone amiss here. And, you know, no matter how worthy the original feminists were, and you know, their ideas were noble, I think what we have been left with really is largely motivated by the sense of envy, and that's been really turned into a cultural virtue, and instead of seeing it as the vice that it in fact is.
Right, right. You're calling a very serious vice a virtue. That's a striking mm-hmm. insight. It strikes me mm-hmm. too, but I'm not sure if you have any familiarity with the work of the sociologist René Girard, but he basically says the gospel, mm-hmm. the purpose of the gospel is to get us over envy, and that's a striking right. thing, that you're this idea yeah. that the modern world is constructed of envy in so many ways, mm-hmm. and it's very mm-hmm. damaging to women, and it makes Mary an unattractive figure to the modern woman because she is not an mm-hmm. envious person.
Right. Yeah. And there's and then of course there's other contortions that come along with it. I mean, think about just the idea of Mary's purity. I mean, this is again one of those things that's so far from our current cultural understanding that it's just hard to even wrap your mind around. But of course, we know with purity also comes the idea that we can see God better. When we have a pure heart, our vision is cleared. We can see more. So I think that it's fascinating to look at these issues. But the bigger thing that's really motivated me is to look at women today and ask the question, are they happy? And there are no indicators that women are happier yes, today than they were before. Everything from obesity, alcoholism, drug abuse, depression numbers, suicide numbers, divorce numbers, all of that is pointing to something very upsetting and deeply troubling about how women are living today.
And Mary herself may offer us a glimpse of a way out of that. More with Dr. Mm-hmm. Carrie Gress when we come back after the break. Our number, 888-318-7884. We're talking Mary and the Modern Woman. 888-318-7884. We'll be right back with your questions for Dr. Carrie Gress right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Hi, this is Bishop James Wall from the Diocese of Gallup, New Mexico. Keep it right here on Catholic Answers Live.
Did the Catholic Church add books to the Bible, or did Protestants remove 7 books from the Old Testament? In Why Catholic Bibles Are Bigger, author Gary Machuda takes you on a fact-filled tour through the history of the Bible, revealing the whole story behind the lost books of the Protestant Old Testament. With the latest information, discourse on crucial issues, and a topical index, Why Catholic Bibles Are Bigger is a book that belongs in the library of every serious student of Scripture. Order your copy of Why Catholic Bibles Are Bigger today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
The Catholic Answers Minute. I'm Father Vincent Serpa. In Luke 14, Jesus dined at the home of a leading Pharisee. Noticing a man with dropsy, Jesus healed him, much to the disdain of the scholars of the law. So he asked them, "Who among you, if your son or ox falls into a cistern, would not immediately pull him out on the Sabbath?" But they were unable to answer his question. The Pharisees and scholars didn't want to acknowledge that Jesus was correct. By showing such charity, he was fulfilling the Sabbath far better than they were with their obsession with keeping external observance of the law only. In itself, showing compassion for those in need is never at odds with our love for God. But ignoring such persons is. The Lord identifies with such people, just as he does with the thousands of innocent babies whose lives are taken through abortion. We need to show compassion for these little ones of his in every way, not the least of which is the way we vote. I'm Father Vincent Serpa for Catholic Answers, Catholic.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Our guest, Dr. Carrie Gress, the author of many things, including The Marian Option, God's Solution to a Civilization in Crisis. And our topic, Mary and the Modern Woman. What is the role of Mary in our understanding of womanhood? And does she still play a role, or is she outdated? Is she passé? Has her time gone by, and now we need a fresher, newer, fitter, fiercer, I don't know, whatever the words are now that people dump on women. You got to be all these things. It does seem to me sometimes, Dr. Gress, actually, let me give out the number again. First of all, 888-318-7884, that sometimes in the name of kind of like being pro-woman, we put an awful lot of pressure on women, like this idea now that everybody's got to be fierce. I mean, fierce mm-hmm. is awfully right. hard word to live up to.
Right. Yeah, I had a hard enough time with ambition. I mean, much less adding fierce to the pile as well. So, yeah, I think that there's a lot of things, that hats that we need to wear that are difficult to put on sometimes, and we're just not predisposed, you know, in our character or disposition to some of those things. So, yeah, it's really challenging.
So, you know, you said a strategy that won't work is, you know, remake Mary, like make, I guess, to turn right. Mary into like a fierce girl or something like that. Mm-hmm. But so who sure. is she? Maybe we should make sure before we go to calls, kind of get a sense of
who our lady is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think that is actually what's interesting about her is, I mean, in the Marian option, I talk about how that she does have courage and strength and this sort of mama bear quality about her. I mean, she's Our Lady, Help of Christians, and there's so many different titles of hers where there's nothing saccharine or pious about her. But I think that there are a lot of things about Our Lady that are quiet, and this is quietness is not something that goes over well in our culture. We, you know, it's mostly, by and large, if you're looking at people who are on TV, a lot of us women are choleric, we're outspoken, we have a lot to say, and this is one of the things that we just don't find in Our Lady in scriptures, particularly, is all the things that she said. She was not a chatty woman, and so I think that that's one of the another reason why it's kind of hard to relate to that. But I think that the one thing that we've also lost is really the sense of her deep interiority, and you know, as a church and as a culture, that is not something that is held up to have any kind of high esteem at all, and yet it's in that interiority where women really do find this deep peace, this deep joy, this deep spirit that can animate their lives and also help them to be fruitful in their lives, not just busy, but actually doing very good things that are of God and in accord with God's will. And so anyway, I think, you know, back to your original question, though, I think that's what's hard is just trying to, you know, all these things that we're so used to being told and relating that back to Mary is difficult. But again, she's beautiful, which is one area that I think we haven't done enough in the church and in educating people about the importance of beauty. Saint Therese has this great example of how she was suffering something and she had this miraculous experience of seeing Our Lady. And it was her beauty that just blocked out all the pain that she was experiencing. Every apparition with Our Lady talks about she's the most beautiful woman I ever saw. And beauty is important to the heart of women. I mean, look at how much money we spend on cosmetics and just beautifying our lives and our homes. And yet we can do that in a way that is ordered to Our Lady. Instead of it being vanity, it can be something that can draw others to God as well. So I think that's another key piece that we need to be mindful of, certainly as women, and what God has really put on our hearts.
That's a real antidote to the kind of utilitarianness of the modern world too, the way everything's got to be efficient and effective, and there's no place for beauty and mm-hmm. even beauty in a way is kind of wasteful, isn't it? It doesn't have a purpose except for itself.
Mm-hmm. Right. No, it seems very very frivolous and something that is a waste on the one hand, or you have other people that just reject it outright and they're going more towards this sort of gender neutrality reality. And yet this is so close to the heart of women and who we are that we love to create an environment where people can really flourish and grow. And I think that's something that's been largely stifled. And we see that this is what Our Lady does in the church. Is there's a reason why she and the church are used almost interchangeably. When you speak about the church, so many of the things that you can say about the church, you can also say very clearly about Our Lady as far as her motherhood.
There's a quality that I imagine you will say is a heroic and beautiful quality of Mary that I think the modern world will say that is a terrible quality of Mary, and that is she's not the central character in her own story. The Gospels are not right. about Mary. They're about Jesus. Right. What do you say to somebody who says, no, like if you, we should have women shouldn't be in a second place to a man like Mary is in a second place to Christ?
Right. Right. Well, I think you hit the nail on the head. This is one of the hard things. I mean, another hard thing, of course, is the reality that, you know, so many of us don't know where the line stops and starts. Do we are as far as changing feminism in the world today? How much do we have to give up to look like Mary? And yet, I think that's a hard piece. But I think what we're really missing is this profound idea of how it is that God wants to speak to our hearts and how it is that God wants to love us. And if we look at religious women, you know, they're just not shutting themselves off for the sake of shutting themselves off in the world. They're not going into convents for that reason. But in fact, they have this passionate experience, this passionate love with our Lord in a way that's hard for us to comprehend on the outside. And yet all of us are called to that in a certain way. And I've written about this, how when women go to prayer, it's so frequently very similar to pregnancy. God will plant a seed in our minds, and it's something that only we know about, and it's very small, and we may disregard it and not think much of it. And then the idea starts to bloom and grow, and we sort of care for it and think about it and try to implement it in the world. And then finally it becomes something far beyond beyond what we ever imagined. So I think, you know, Mother Angelica is a perfect example of this, of something that started out very small and, you know, look what has become with her networks. So as a result, you know, we can see the same pattern with pregnancy, where we know that we're pregnant, and it's, or we have an inkling of it, and then it grows. This person grows within us and becomes something far beyond that. And so I think getting on these issues, talking about these issues of the heart of a woman and what it is that speaks to her in these quiet ways that seem so inaccessible in our own culture, is really a vital thing that we can do as a church, and certainly as, you know, women who are can mentor other women and talk about these issues in our own lives. I think oftentimes a lot of women feel like, well, I don't know enough to really mentor other people. But younger women or women who are new to the faith really need to have someone teach them these things, because it's hard to find them sometimes, I think.
888-318-7884, our number. I would monopolize you for the whole show if I could, but we have to go to calls. Bruce in Modesto, California, listening on Relevant Radio. You are on with Dr. Carrie Gress. Bruce, your question.
Hi, doctor. Thank you for taking this question.
Sure.
My daughters are currently 17 and 20. The younger one, we homeschooled her through PSR. Her catechesis, not strong. I was her mentor. And it's come to the point now where she goes to Mass, but really only for the larger services, Christmas, etc. And I don't think her in causing a stir every week. You know, it just didn't work out for her. You know, she has to want to come to Mass.
Bruce?
My priest each time for my lack of catechizing her in the proper manner. And I'm just wondering, my question is, do I need to keep confessing this as a sin? Am I still responsible for her spiritual growth and that kind of,
Thank you, Bruce.
Sure. That's a great question. It's a great question. And I think the first thing that I would say to you is, be at peace. I mean, the fact of the matter is, you have got New York, the fashion industry. You've got Washington, D.C. and the public policy industry. You've got media. You've got Hollywood. And you have the music industry that are all plotting against every effort that you could possibly make with your daughter. So she's getting all of these ideas from this elite group of women. I've started calling them the matriarchy, who are forming her ideas in a way that you know, you almost have to, just have more grace than I feel for you, because I feel like there's only so much that as parents we can do, especially when we have this whole world against us in so many different ways, and our friends, and just the culture is so difficult. So what I would suggest is start praying your rosary for her. Start focusing on that. Don't stop. I don't think, if you've confessed this and you've gone through this, I think that you can probably stop with that, because it's probably not being very constructive. And I think the big thing, you know, this is one of the things that I have discovered too, is it's very important to obviously, love her for who she is and try and find common ground in certain ways. But I think that it's really is going to take great grace to get her back to that place where she needs to be. And as her dad, you've got it. But at the same time, Our Lady can help you with that too.
Bruce, thank you very, very much for that call. Our number, 888-318-7884. We're talking with Dr. Carrie Gress about Mary and the modern woman. If you have questions about Mary or how she fits with the idea of a modern woman, give us a call, 888-318-7884.
Join us on air today on Catholic Answers Live.
Now, not only can you watch EWTN anywhere, but anytime with EWTN On Demand. Get on-demand access to more than 12,000 EWTN programs, including live shows and specials, all in one place, all free. Just go to EWTN.com/on-demand. There's nothing to fill out, no memberships required, and no fees to pay. All you need is an internet connection, and you're good to go. EWTN On Demand. Fast, easy, and free.
Monsignor Robert Hugh Benson's masterpiece, Lord of the World, is, in a word, prophetic. Originally published in 1907, it depicts a world where relativism has triumphed over objectivity, a world where, in the name of tolerance, religious doctrine is not tolerated. It is a world where euthanasia is practiced widely and religion hardly practiced at all. The lord of this nightmare world is a benign-looking politician intent on power in the name of peace and intent on the destruction of religion in the name of truth. Author Dale Alquist said it best, whether or not Monsignor Benson's picture of our future is accurate, the fact is his picture of our present is chillingly accurate. Recommended by Pope Benedict XVI and by Pope Francis, Lord of the World is a must-read. It's also the latest release in the Catholic Answers Classics series. Order your copy of Lord of the World now by calling 1-888-291-8000 or by visiting Catholic.com or by asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Carrie Gress is our guest. Her latest book, The Marian Option, God's Solution to a Civilization in Crisis. And we're talking about Mary and the modern woman. 888-318-7884 is our number. I want to encourage you once again to sign up for the Catholic Answers Radio Club. It's free and you get all kinds of cool stuff. Right now you get a free MP3 of Jimmy's talk from this year's national conference just about a little more than a month ago, What the Reformation Was All About. Just sign up for Radio Club and you get it. And then as we post new free MP3s, you get those as well. And each week we send you a newsletter update on what's going on here in the audio department of Catholic Answers. Just go to catholic.com/radioclub. Sign up now and get your free MP3 of Jimmy Akin's talk, What the Reformation Was All About. Dr. Gress, lots of calls, so maybe we should just go back to them.
Great.
All right. Bill in Sacramento, your question for Dr. Carrie Gress.
Hello, Dr. Gress. It's a privilege. I was wondering if the fathers have ever written about the woman of virtue in the last chapter of Proverbs. Her value is above pearls.
Right.
Have they ever written about that as a type of Mary? And also maybe you could expand upon Queen Jezebel as the anti-Mary.
Right. No, I think that's a great question. And one of the things that I have been astounded by is looking back at a lot of medieval work on related to Our Lady and related to women. And one of the things that frustrates me is we oftentimes I think we're trying to within the church promote womanhood, but we're using sort of contemporary terms. But if you look back at what has really animated the souls of so many women it's not this contemporary stuff. It's things that are older. I mean, it's not like this was a new thing that women were interested in the church. In fact, it should be almost a slam dunk that we can bring women back to the church because of the fact that there's so many rich and incredible ideas. And this is what I've started discovering was St. Bonaventure has some beautiful work on women. And then St. Albert the Great actually has a book on the Proverbs. It's a commentary in the Proverbs, and he speaks very explicitly about Mary, and it's actually a fascinating, the introduction of it is fascinating because he loops the church and Mary and real women in such a way that you kind of have to read through it very carefully to figure out who does he really mean. And sometimes he means all three, and sometimes he just means Mary, and sometimes it's just the church, and you know, so on. But there's just an incredible wealth out there, I think, of a lot of these ideas that we just really don't tap into to give women, you know, this deeper spiritual life that I think so many of us are yearning for, even though we may not even know it. We're looking for something, but we may not even know it. And in fact, there was recently I just read this article in a secular journal. It was talking about how so many millennial women, they want to just go home and bake bread. They, you know, they've got these great careers. They're making a lot of money. They want to go home and start have a garden. They want to just give it all up and raise a bunch of kids. And you know, it's these are the deep things that I think of so many women desire, and yet we don't give them much of an outlet to really understand why it is that we're desiring them and how it is that we can live them out in a way where we still feel true to ourselves and we feel like we're, you know, contemporary modern women simultaneously. So I think that's is a great question, and going back to some of these ideas would certainly be helpful. But yes, Jezebel is the one piece scripturally that it hearkens to this idea of a kind of anti-Mary. There's some other in the New Testament. You have discussion of different spirits. Certainly, the idea of John talking about the Antichrist as a movement, not as an individual, it also sort of sets it up so that you can think about it in terms of an anti-Mary.
Bill, thank you so much for that call. 888-318-7884, our number. We're talking with Dr. Carrie Grass about Mary and the modern woman. The idea of the woman of virtue in Proverbs 31 there, it got me thinking, one of the images of womanhood that we have now that's all the rage everywhere is the really crass comedic woman. Mm-hmm. The woman just right. That her vulgarity has to be even more outrageous than the man's vulgarity. Mm-hmm. And her crass earthiness. And does Mary, what's the Marian reply to that idea?
Right. Well, I think this is part of the anti-Mary, is this idea that women have to become, they feel like they have to model themselves after men, and not even good men. They're modeling them after the worst of men, and sort of this competition of we can be more crass and vulgar than you can. I was reading somewhere recently that women drop the F-bomb more than men do now. So this is not something that's just isolated to comedians or even to the elite. It's something that's spread out, I think, amongst the culture. So yeah, I think it's certainly a serious problem. And of course, you know, what would be a Marian response to that? Well, you know, other than an eye roll and being horrified. And
which might be the best response you can give to it.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I don't know how you respond to that other than just, you know, praying for these women that have been so seriously misguided. And the sad thing is, you know, I mentioned this article before of these women that were having these desires to bake bread and grow gardens. The response they were given was that, well, we just need more feminism, you know, that to either kind of root this out of you. You know, it was just this remarkable response. You know, we haven't done it right yet. We're not just like men, I guess, without saying that. So
it's a striking kind of feminism that says it's not real feminism until all women root out their feelings and become something other than what they want to be.
Right. So much for being pro-choice. Well, I think it's remarkable. And I think that's astounding, you know, for those of us that have children, especially more than sort of the comfortable number of two, you know, you get a lot of remarks about it. And it's just incredible, you know, people that on one side of their mouth talk about choice and then the other side have a really big problem if you do decide to have, you know, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 children. So, yeah, it's remarkable.
888-318-7884, our number. Dan in Kalamazoo, Michigan, listening on 91.5 FM. You are on with Dr. Carrie Grass. What's your question, please?
Hi, Doctor. One thing that I am concerned about is I don't see the emphasis on vocations for females like we used to have and I think it begins at the kind of the parish level. But I remember my mother talking about out of her Catholic class, they had four or five ladies that went right to the convent. And quite frankly, I don't even see it brought up. I see in our parish, for every five or six male seminarians, there might be maybe one that's a female that's maybe headed to a convent somewhere. How can we do a better job of that? And what's your view of that?
Right. No, I think that's a great question. I recently heard a story about a priest. Unfortunately, I don't know who he is or where he is, but he was a farmer. He is a farmer. And he thought that he was really concerned about vocations and what he could do about them. And so recognizing that there's this important way to cultivate fruit in a farm, he thought, how do I do that within a family? And so he started out with moms. He started out a mother's group. And then from there, I think he did a couples group with added the husbands in. Then he added a men's group. And then finally, he added a groups for young men and women, Bible studies. And from there, the vocations really started to come. But he recognized the importance of, you know, the soil, so to speak, and that's really women. And I think that's part of it. Again, you know, in the previous two questions ago, I was just mentioning how much the culture is against women and really in so many ways dictates the way that we think. I mean, we don't realize how much of this is happening, but it really is astounding if you start looking at this common message that we're getting from elite women. And so as a result, mothers and women, and, you know, you see that there's not this great value placed, even on the family or certainly on vocation. So that's part of the problem, is just that the way the family has fallen apart. Of course, there were, you know, it was certainly fallout from the Second Vatican Council that we could talk about another day. So that goes into it. But yes, I think that it's a hard sell, because certainly the women that do discover it, I've even seen situations where the parents were so against it, because we see our children not as someone that God has created for his own means, but they're sort of our own possession, and we don't want God taking them away. So I've seen a situation in particular where there was a woman who had a vocation, thought she had a vocation of the Carmelites. She spent several months with them, and then finally the pressure from her family was just too much, and she couldn't continue the vocation. And I think that happens a lot as well. But, you know, incredible amounts of pressure from family as well as peers, and it just seems very radical and outside of our everyday experience. A lot of people don't even begin to think about it.
Dan, what do you think?
Yeah, no, I agree 100%, and I wish it wasn't so, because
so do I.
I think it probably begins in the family, and then but the parish has to emphasize it. I never even, you know, and I know the priest is very busy, but I never even see it brought up or talked about the way it is even the seminarians for the men.
Right.
So
right.
Just thinking that way.
Well, and, you know, I have to give a lot of credit to our priests, because the one thing that I think is incredibly difficult is to say anything about women in the church today. Because what happens if he says something that some woman is unhappy with? Well, she'll come tell the bishop. She'll round up all of her friends. They'll all talk about it. They'll go in there outraged to the bishop. And suddenly he's branded as this sexist priest, when in fact he didn't say anything that was sexist at all. So I think much of this has to really fall at the feet of women, because it's much harder to call me sexist than it would be to any priest. But I think that this is really a difficult issue to wade into, because, and I think it also focuses on the reality that a lot of times arguments, especially among feminism, just are non-existent. If you pay attention to what is supposed to be an argument about anything related to radical feminism, basically all that you're seeing is a temper tantrum. There's a lot of emotion, there's a lot of name-calling, but there's not a lot of argumentation there. And I think that I was astounded when I started paying attention to this, that it comes down to really, very emotions, a lot of rage, a lot of anger. And, you know, these are not places where you can actually start a constructive conversation when you've got people that are, you know, that angry about a lot of issues. So I feel for priests who are put in this position where they want to help women, but they're afraid because they know that they've either, you know, stepped on that rake before, or, you know, they're afraid to do it again.
Dan, thank you very, very much for that call. We have to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Mary and the Modern Woman with Dr. Carrie Gress right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers. Our success depends on you. I fell away from the practice of my Catholic faith in my college years. But after I got married and we were expecting our first child, I had an enormous tug to come back to my roots. I went to an incredible Catholic store in my town and was blown away by the kindness and knowledge of the staff. They not only recommended books for me and my bride, but they promised me prayer support for my journey back to the faith. Wow, what an incredible Catholic store. I have to credit them for helping me on my journey home to the Catholic Church. Now they consider me part of their family, and I have shared with them my oldest son's desire to become a Catholic priest someday. An incredible Catholic store in your area can be found at incrediblecatholicstore.com. That's incrediblecatholicstore.com. The Incredible Catholic Store, transforming the world one soul at a time.
Just like the saints of the Counter-Reformation, our own souls are in constant need of reform, of reconversion to God and His will for us. We struggle with sin. We become distracted in prayer. We find it hard to be loving and easy to be selfish. In Reform Yourself, Sean McAfee shows you how these magnificent saints can be guides to your own personal transformation. We all need to reform our souls. Let the saints who reformed the church show you how. Order your copy of Reform Yourself today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their faith and values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Dr. Douglas Beaumont, former evangelical minister and PhD in theology, will be here with us to talk about the ideas of sola fide and sola scriptura. That is Martin Luther's idea that scripture alone should be our guide and that our faith alone saves us. Are those ideas still intellectually tenable ideas? Given all of the scholarship and understanding that has happened in the last 500 years, that's going to be a fascinating hour. Please be here with us. This hour, we're talking with Dr. Carrie Gress, one of our very favorite guests, about one of our very favorite people, Mary, and how she relates to modern women, and especially maybe the idea of modern womanhood. Lots and lots of calls, Dr. Gress. So we go now to, did we just drop a call? Oh, sorry. All right. Well, let's go to John in Kansas City. John, you are on with Dr. Carrie Gress. Your question, please.
Hi. Can you hear me?
We can.
Hi, John. Yep.
Okay. Hey, Carrie, you wrote an article about the best Catholic priest you never heard of.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Father James Flanagan.
Right. Uh-huh.
And did he have something to do with your formation and marriage prep?
Right. He did, actually. Father James Flanagan was the founder of SOLT, the Society of Our Lady of the Trinity. And I happened to be living in Rome when he was living in Rome, and we had a mutual friend who put us in touch. And initially I went on a retreat with him, actually when I was just visiting Rome before I moved there. But when I moved to Italy, I started seeing him regularly for spiritual direction. And during that time, I also met my husband, and he did our marriage prep. And, you know, it was one of these things that you could never script this, what happened in our marriage prep. But we were supposed to meet with him for six meetings. And our first meeting was, of course, beautiful, insightful, because Father Flanagan was just an amazing priest. But then when we went back, he actually said, you know, I was praying, and Jesus and Mary told me I needed to do something different with you two. And so he ended up giving us this remarkable, very specific kind of marriage prep to my husband and I. And, you know, at that time I was taking copious notes, and I actually got some of the notes that were part of his marriage prep that his secretary was able to forward me. And I kind of forgot about him. And then, you know, fast forward 9 years, and I've started doing a lot of work on women, which, of course, when I finished my PhD, I vowed I would never do. And, of course, here I am doing it. But one of the things that he had spoken to us about very specifically was this idea of the valiant woman and really understanding who women are within this context of Mary that, you know, is not something that, that is just something in the past, but in fact can be related to our lives. And so hopefully at some point I will get permission and I'll be able to publish this, because his insights were incredibly beautiful and helpful, certainly as a new wife, but even, you know, 9 years out, just going back to read them again, I was amazed at how helpful they were to me as a wife, but I can see how helpful they are now, you know, and now I'm doing this work related to women.
John?
Well, I love reading your stuff.
Oh, thank you.
You're still there? I love reading
yep.
your stuff because of that connection. And I just want you to know that he gave me marriage prep in 1979.
Wow, that's great.
And did, so, it, did it take? Like you stayed married or did it?
No, I'm still married.
Okay.
7 years later.
Well, that's a relief, John.
That's beautiful.
John, thank you very, very much for that call.
Thank you.
Do you write somewhere regularly, Dr. Gress? I mean, if he's going to be a fan like that.
I usually write I blog for the National Catholic Register pretty regularly. I'm sort of interspersed at other Catholic sites, but you know, right now I'm actually working on a couple books, so I'm not writing too much freelancing or blogging.
You know, we publish books. You're aware of this, right?
Oh, you do?
Yes, we do. Don't act like you don't know. You should. We should get to a look at some of your manuscripts before they go out. 888-318-7884. Our number. We go now to Joseph in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, listening to EWTN on XM radio, satellite radio. Joseph, your question for Dr. Carrie Gress.
Yeah. Hi. Good evening. There was a couple observations I wanted to make. First off, you guys are hitting on all cylinders, as far as I can tell. The one gentleman that called in was concerned about his daughters. I'm in a similar situation.
Mm-hmm.
But the truth of the matter is a dedication to live a life like Mary, if you're a woman, is a matter of choice. And this world doesn't condone that kind of a choice too often.
Right.
The other thing is this weekend, for example, the gospel was all about the Beatitudes. And we've heard them 100 mm-hmm. times over our lifetime. But if you really look at those, sometimes I've thought that that Mary actually is the personification of all those Beatitudes with her life. And then finally, my question is this. I often wonder, we feel remorse when we sin against our God and Savior.
Mm-hmm.
I often wondered if there's ever been a motion or a movement within the church to mm-hmm. recognize the fact that Mary deserves a similar apology for what we did to her and her son.
Mm-hmm. Right. No, I think that's a great question. And what the most obvious answer is, of course, the first Saturday devotions for Our Lady of Fatima, especially since this is a tomorrow Saturday. Tomorrow is the first Saturday. And it's the day when we can really make reparation for the sins against the Immaculate Heart. That's really the part of the message that she gave to Sister Lucia and why it is that the first Saturday devotions are so important. That she asked for us to go to Mass for 5 days in a row. Anyway, there's lots of details related to it, but it is this focus on really making up for the transgressions against the Immaculate Heart of Mary. So, yeah, I think that's a great question. And it's fascinating that there really can be a response to that. That's something we ought to make a response to because, of course, we know that how significantly she suffered for us with her son.
Joseph, thank you very, very much for that call. Our number is 888-318-7884. We're talking with Dr. Carrie Gress about Mary and the modern woman. Dr. Gress, a young girl today has these figures. Like I'm in my own mind, I'm thinking of a commercial I saw the other day with my son. I don't know. It was for a concert or something for Katy Perry. And the amount of color and beauty and all that. I said to him, as a matter of fact, I said, if I was a 10-year-old girl, that's where I'd want to be. Like, that is so powerful.
Right.
I'm sure that Katy Perry is a very fine person and all that, but that's not an image of womanhood to compete mm-hmm. with what the with what Christ is offering and with what Mary is leading us to. So how do we communicate with these young girls who have this overwhelming kind of assault on their womanhood before it's even formed?
Right. You know, one of the ways that we can do that, I mean, most of the things that motivate girls is our boys, is really trying to appeal to the opposite sex. And I have been fascinated to start looking at, well, what is it that boys and men say about women when they don't know that we're listening, when they don't think that they're going to be censured for what it is that they're saying and, you know, just nod because their wife is standing next to them. But in fact, if we look back at poetry, we look at music, at lyrics, we can see that throughout the ages, there's really this continuum of ideas that motivate men about women. Mystery, modesty, all of these there's so many different elements, beauty, kindness, all of these kinds of elements come through in music. And yet, this is the exact opposite track, sort of what women are taught that they need to live. And, you know, this is one of the profound insights of my own life, was even though I had come back to the faith, I was still focusing on what it was that the world was telling me I had to do to make myself happy. So, you know, I thought I was doing all the right things. I was you know, working on K Street in Washington, D.C. I was doing a PhD in philosophy, and I was assertive and you know, made my arguments and all kinds of things. And yet I realized that relationship after relationship was ending, and these relationships would end and these men would go and marry school teachers. And I was just astounded by this. What is it that these school teachers have that I didn't have? I thought I was doing everything the right way. And I think, you know, it was remarkable when I started actually paying attention to what men said and through lyrics and whatnot, but also in private conversations. And I wasn't eavesdropping, and I was just paying attention, and sweetness was something that came up. And I was just flabbergasted, like, sweetness, really? Like, this is something that's important? I mean, it had never been presented to me as something that was important. And even as women, we think of, you know, sweetness as either being manipulative or just stupid. And so it was hard for me to even figure out how I could live that out. And so I think this is one of the things, is that mixed message that we're sending as a culture, as women to young girls, that, oh, this is what's really going to get you attention and what is going to get you love, when in fact there's this whole opposite course that we can take that is actually going to feed the desires of our hearts and bring us true kinds of happiness.
888-318-7884, our number. We also get questions given to us on Facebook and YouTube. And a viewer on YouTube asks, what did some of the earliest Christians say about Mary and her queenship, her motherhood, and her intercession?
Right. Well, we know from the very early centuries that there was an intercession to Our Lady, or there was a recognition of her intercession. I think the earliest prayer that we have is from the 3rd century, 251 or something. I can't remember the exact year. And it's recognizing her deep intercession. That's what we've got. But a lot of these things are also things that just developed through Mariology, and we over time have developed. So we don't have a lot necessarily related to her queenship. It was more in the early church, it was focused on this idea of the new Eve. And in fact, you know, I think this is a great way to look at it. Look at what Eve does. Eve says no to God. Eve says, I'm going to do it how I want it to do it. She brings a curse to her family, whereas Mary is a blessing to her family, where Mary brings to her family beautiful and good things and this restoring of a relationship with God. And I think that's something we have to be mindful of as Catholic women, is focusing on how is it that we can be a blessing to our family instead of bringing, you know, evil to our lives. And mm-hmm. and you know, even an exorcist I was listening to talk recently was talking about how Satan is always trying to bring violence, division, and disunity. And we can see those things very prominently among this sort of radical feminism that we have. I mean, even looking at the fact that we've got 55 million babies that have been aborted, I think it's a pretty clear indication that the violence is there and the disunity is happening, and just this crisis that we're seeing among vocations to even marriage, much less the religious life and priesthood.
I never would have thought to go that direction. What girls are interested in is boys and men.
Right.
But that, Grace builds on nature, doesn't it? And that our natural tendency to care for one another and be attracted to one another and love one another, it's good. It's not bad in any way. And if we follow that, it will lead to good things.
Amen. Yep, indeed.
Dr. Carrie Grass, thank you so much for just a wonderful hour. I hope you'll come back next week and do, next month. I said next week, but we're already scheduled next week. Sorry about that. Next month.
That's
next,
all right.
Next hour, Doug Beaumont will be here to talk about Sola Scriptura, Sola Fide. We'll be right back after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free, 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
We always save something really good for the last hour of the work week here at Catholic Answers, and we did it again this week. Douglas Beaumont is our guest. Our topic, sola fide and sola scriptura. If you're not familiar with those two terms, you might be a Catholic. You're certainly not a Lutheran or other mainline Protestant. Probably most Protestants are familiar with sola fide, sola scriptura, by faith alone and by scripture alone are the essential meaning of those two things. So let's get right to the nub of the question. Is it still possible to be an intellectually honest Christian and still believe in those ideas of Luther about sola fide and sola scriptura? Our guest, as I said, is Douglas Beaumont. He has a PhD in theology from Northwest University, an MA in apologetics from Southern Evangelical Seminary, where he served as assistant to President Norman Geisler and taught Bible and religion for 10 years. Norman Geisler, that's a big deal. Doug, he's a big famous guy. He's now the author, a Catholic, and he's the author of Evangelical Exodus, Evangelical Seminarians and Their Paths to Rome. Douglas Beaumont, thanks for being with us.
Appreciate being on, Si. Thanks a lot.
Didn't Geisler write a book with a Catholic guy at one point? Didn't they do like a...
Well, he actually wrote two major books on Catholicism. The first one was with Ralph McKenzie, who actually coined the phrase Evangelical Exodus that I used in my book.
Okay.
And then the second one was with a young man named Joshua Betancourt, okay, called Is Rome the True Church? Well, about a week after that book hit the shelves, it came out that Josh had become Catholic. So it was pulled back off the shelves. and Josh now is a contributor to one of the chapters in the Evangelical Exodus book.
Well, tell us a little bit about Evangelical Exodus. Is it true that evangelical seminarians are discovering something in the Catholic Church and heading over across the Tiber, as they say?
Yeah, I wouldn't characterize it as a flood or anything, to maybe mix my metaphors, but in this particular seminary that all of us were from, Southern Evangelical, it's a fairly small school. It's not attached to a major denomination or a church. Most of the people went there specifically because they wanted to learn from Norman Geisler, learn his brand of apologetics and defending the faith. Mm-hmm. And every couple of years, two or three people would get lost to the Catholic Church. And when my number finally came up, I got in touch with a lot of these folks. And because I knew the rumors that were circulating around the school and everything, having been, you know, very deeply involved. And I said, hey, you know, why don't we put together a book that tells the story from our own perspectives and let us kind of get our voice out there. And it turned out pretty good. So I sent it off to Ignatius Press and they picked it up for us.
Ignatius Press, the largest publisher in the universe. I don't know if you know that. That's an inside joke between me and the president of Ignatius Press.
Who was on the show yesterday.
Oh, yeah. So you heard that. Well, congratulations on the book. I mean, what are the common threads with these young people? I assume mostly young people who have been seminarians at evangelical seminaries and moved to the Catholic faith. What common threads?
Yeah, there are a few. I would say the stories are fairly unique, but we did all come from the same seminary, so we all started off with a lot of the same interests, particularly in a philosophical kind of classical form of apologetics that actually, kind of ironically, very heavily relied on Thomas Aquinas and his writings up to a certain point. So Thomas Aquinas was certainly a common thread with several of us. The basic issues that we're talking about today, sola fide and sola scriptura, were obviously at the forefront of our discussions. And then also just seeking after orthodoxy and justifying the Bible. These, I think, really came more from our apologetic background, that we were being trained to defend the faith, defend the Bible. But then you have to ask, well, what is the Bible? Why is this Bible different from another one? Or why are we defending this set of doctrines versus this other set of doctrines? And the deeper and deeper a lot of us dug, the more we kept running into the Catholic Church, and eventually that that couldn't be ignored. So I would say those are some of the major things. In fact, we all wanted to write about them so much that we pulled them out of our personal story chapters and put them in the back of the book in appendices so that we wouldn't have a 1,000-page-long book.
So that's fascinating. So Norm Geisler was using Aquinas to teach you how to do apologetics.
Yeah, absolutely. It was not unusual to see somebody walking around the campus with the Summa Theologiae under one arm and, you know, John MacArthur under the other. It was just an eclectic blend, basically, that up to a certain point in apologetics, when you're dealing with the nature of reality, epistemology, metaphysics, and then the nature of God, I mean, Thomas Aquinas was the man. I mean, he might have been the patron saint of the program if we had such things. And Geisler's use of his material was fairly well known by that point. But what would happen is a lot of people would come in to learn apologetics, and then they would end up spending a lot of time learning Thomistic philosophy. And so that really, I think, had a big effect on a lot of us.
Yeah, that'll set the stage for it, won't it? And but I guess it should be said, a person like Norman Geisler, a great Christian man, in many ways, we find ourselves allies in a world that has rejected God, has rejected Christ, has rejected even the idea that there are things like physical realities, like manhood and womanhood. Wouldn't you agree with that?
Absolutely. One of the things that I found interesting about his writings in the school was that in his first book, he actually devotes an entire section of the book to the agreements that evangelicals and Catholics have together, and it's substantial. Not enough for us to be in communion with one another, but right. on numerous doctrines, evangelicals rely on the councils of the Catholic Church for their orthodoxy. They rely on the Catholic Church for their New Testament. So there is quite a bit of agreement, and especially on moral issues. Evangelicals in general kind of came around eventually to many of the moral teachings of the Catholic Church as well. And a lot of them, not all, but a lot of them are more than happy to link arms and fight for the unborn and things like that.
888-318-7884 is our number. Douglas Beaumont is our guest, and we're talking sola fide, sola scriptura, those two important solas. Those aren't the only solas. Am I correct? There are two more.
There are five altogether.
Oh, there's three. Let me just check my math. Okay, so that means three more, right?
Three more.
Yeah. Okay, I can do. That's my level of math right there.
There you go. Yeah, the two that were really, we would say probably the most disagreement over would be sola scriptura, which is the idea that the Bible alone is the authority for the Christian, and that's fleshed out in different ways depending on which Protestant tradition you come from. And then sola fide, which is that people are saved or justified by faith alone, and that, again, is fleshed out differently depending on which tradition you come from. But those are considered the two major causes for the Reformation, the sola scriptura being the formal cause or kind of the recipe, the form behind the Reformation. And then its major fruit, its material cause, one of the major specifics said to have come out of the Bible alone is the idea that we're saved by faith alone. And so those two are really the driving force behind the Protestant Reformation.
Again, 888-318-7884 is our number. I imagine there's something, and I'm actually asking you this as a question, but it strikes me that, I'm a cradle Catholic myself, but going from evangelicalism to Catholicism means, well, let's say if you went one way from Catholicism to evangelical Protestantism, everything that you had believed, you can still believe. You're just losing some things, but Christ is still there, and the Gospels are still. But as an evangelical going to Catholicism, and I may be oversimplifying this, there's a whole lot of new stuff you gotta put in your, collective bag of credo. I believe these things. Did you in yourself have a lot of resistance to taking on all these new things?
I think that the additions are some of the biggest difficulties. I think that a lot of people that make the move that direction start to see problems with evangelicalism or with whatever Protestant tradition they're in. And so they don't really have trouble letting go of those things. And depending on how direct of a route they take to get to Catholicism, there are a number of things that have to be dealt with. I mean, I personally spent a solid 5 years wrestling with these issues and looking at, you know, what other options are there besides Catholicism.
Yeah.
I was certainly not attracted in the sense that I thought, oh, Catholicism looks good. Let me see if I can argue my way in. I spent more of my time trying to argue my way out. You know, when you're adding, you know, obviously, I mean, the most obvious ones would be the Marian doctrines. You know, you've got to deal with the sacraments too. Yeah, you've got a new view of some sacraments, and you've got a sacramental view of the sacraments for all of them. And you've got the papacy to deal with, and then you've got all of the historical issues, you know, the Crusades and the Inquisition. And, oh my gosh, I'm gonna have to deal with all of that as well. It's a very, very big project to make the move in that direction.
But you did, in fact, come to see that what you had accepted, the solas, that is that we're saved by faith alone and that our only authority is Scripture alone, that this was not true. So what put you over the edge on those two? What brought you to see that those solas are not true?
Well, sola fide, to begin with, was something that we taught. Now, I you know, evangelicalism isn't technically Protestant, but we still borrow most of the theology from them. The difficulty that I had with sola fide is that nobody could seem to agree on what it meant. Everybody was required to say, "I believe we're saved by faith alone," sign on the dotted line. But then everybody was allowed to disagree on what faith meant and what alone meant. So, you know, a two-word affirmation that can have, you know, numerous meanings poured into it is not terribly difficult to give up in a sense. Mm-hmm. The Catholic view is not very far off from some Protestant views. So I would say giving up sola fide was more about picking the one view that's not allowed in Protestantism to stand in place of sola fide. And I think Jimmy Akin was on a couple days ago and explained it like this, that, you know, Catholics can affirm that we're saved by faith alone, as long as faith is understood correctly and alone is understood correctly, mm-hmm. which actually is what Protestants teach as well. You've got a Calvinist version, you've got a free grace version, you've got Luther's version.
Yeah.
I mean, for heaven's sakes, Luther believed that faith in baptism is what saved. I don't know anybody that teaches that in evangelicalism, but that's not the sort of thing that you typically study. So sola fide wasn't difficult for me to give up in the sense that I had already given up numerous versions of sola fide. I just held on to the one that I held to. As far as sola scriptura, that was a lot more difficult because it just seems true on the face of it that if you have a collection of documents that are inspired by God, and this is something Protestants and Catholics both agree on, that this is the only collection of inspired writings, that clearly in any kind of battle of authority, the Bible has to come out on top. There's really a strong intuition there that's just got to be right. And anybody mm-hmm. that denies that, I mean, you just... an atheist would buy into that argument. You know, they may not accept the premises, but
Right. Even
an atheist could understand that if you have an actually inspired document, that no non-inspired body can have authority over it.
Yeah. Well, if you have a book from God, that should be the boss, right? That is intuitive. Yeah, right. That has a very powerful, just intuitive weight.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, that's a pretty solid trump card, you know, that, well, this one was written by God.
Okay.
So, you know, some of the things that made it difficult, though, first of all, once again, there's a difference of opinion over what sola scriptura means. Does it mean that the Bible is the only source of authority, in which case, if it's not in the Bible, you don't get to believe it? Okay, so that's kind of your far fundamentalist side. Or is it more of a Protestant traditional view where the Bible is the ultimate authority, but you had better understand it according to this particular confession or this particular doctrinal statement. And so it loses its teeth in a sense, because if I believe in sola scriptura and I'm at First Baptist and then I decide, well, I don't believe in the rapture anymore, well, I can just walk right across the street and be a sola scriptura Presbyterian. And what I started to realize was, gosh, you know, I mean, just the way this works out, everybody can be sola scriptura if the scriptura can be understood in just about any way that you want it to. And so just looking historically at what actually happened, what was a pretty big wake-up call, to look outside the evangelical bubble that I was in and say, wow, all of these people are teaching sola scriptura. And then in my doctoral studies, I'm reading the books by the people that know Hebrew, they know Greek, they've done all the textual studies, and every one of those groups has disagreements, even though they've got their scholars on their side. And so it just, I think a lot of it wasn't so much that I disagreed with the bare statement of sola scriptura, as it just seemed obviously not able to work. If you don't have an authoritative interpretation of this authoritative book, then you become your own authority, and that's the history of Protestantism.
And thus the history of the modern world as well. We are all our own authorities, and eventually we all become our own moral authorities.
Sure.
And that's the great disaster of the late modern period. But we will get into that and more when we come back. Sola Fide, Sola Scriptura is our topic today. Douglas Beaumont is our guest. 888-31-TRUTH is our number, and we'll be right back with more after this.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at Catholic.com.
Hello, my friends. Chris Check here, president of Catholic Answers. It's October, the month of the Holy Rosary, and it's also the month Catholic Answers starts its winter sale at shop.catholic.com. We are offering great discounts on all of the books, DVDs, CDs, ebooks, and MP3s that we carry. We have great new releases in church history, scripture, apologetics, spiritual formation, Bible prophecy, and lives of saints. In other words, something for everyone. What's more, our shop site has been completely redesigned. It's much easier to navigate and use. Indeed, you should visit shop.catholic.com just to see the new site. Just enter the promo code WINTER at checkout and you'll save 20% off your total purchase. That's right, 20% off hundreds of great Catholic books, DVDs, CDs, ebooks, and MP3s from now until the end of the year. That's shop.catholic.com.
Pope Francis said, "All of us are called to mature in our work as evangelizers. We want to have better training, a deepening love, and a clearer witness to the gospel. St. Paul Street Evangelization's online school of evangelization will equip you with the tools you need to be an effective evangelist. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you're unable to give, we'll set you up for free. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Just like the saints of the Counter-Reformation, our own souls are in constant need of reform, of reconversion to God and His will for us. We struggle with sin. We become distracted in prayer. We find it hard to be loving and easy to be selfish. In Reform Yourself, Sean McAfee shows you how these magnificent saints can be guides to your own personal transformation. We all need to reform our souls. Let the saints who reformed the church show you how. Order your copy of Reform Yourself today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, Friday edition, so you know it's going to be good. 888-31-TRUTH, our number. We're talking Sola Fide and Sola Scriptura. I do want to invite you to call if you're not Catholic, and we promise to be friendly and engage in, well, we'll try to keep the level of the discourse unrough. I couldn't come up with the right word. It'll be polite and friendly. That's what I'm looking for. If you would like to defend Sola Fide or Sola Scriptura, or if you just have a question about what Catholics believe about the Protestant teachings of Sola Fide and Sola Scriptura, Douglas Beaumont, former evangelical minister, PhD in theology from Northwest University, is our guest. And he's also the author of Evangelical Exodus, Evangelical Seminarians and Their Paths to Rome. I don't think unrough is a word, but I'm going to stay with it. I don't know if it's Jesus or Jesus, how you pronounce it, in Battle Creek, Michigan, watching on YouTube. Is it Jesus?
Hi, Sai. Can you hear me?
I can. How do I pronounce your name?
It's Jesus.
Okay. All right. Jesus, your question for Doug Beaumont.
Hi, Doug. Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you, yeah, Jesus. Good to have you on the show.
Perfect. Oh, yeah, good to talk to you. Well, I have an easy question for you. So what was the theological issue over which there can be many opinions that finally tipped the scales for you, that made you realize that sola scriptura was just untenable, kind of like the straw that broke the camel's back?
Oh, that's a good question. Thank you. I always like opinion questions because I can't get them wrong. Yeah, I think honestly, reading about Luther was a big part of that. I mean, theologically, the difficulty that he had promoting sola fide, actually, strangely enough, the two really kind of went together for me. You know, if sola fide means faith alone, it's typically fleshed out as that we are justified by faith alone. That was, again, the material cause of the Reformation. I mean, Luther said that the church stands or falls on this doctrine, the whole thing. And I learned, quite to my astonishment, actually, I'd never really noticed it before, that the only verse in Scripture that uses the words is James 2:24, where he says that justification is not by faith alone. Now, you know, I teach logic, and you don't need logic to get the problem, but you know, this is a verbal contradiction. It's a straight contradiction to hold that justification is by faith alone when the Scripture teaches that justification is not by faith alone. You can't get any more contradictory than just putting the word "not" in an affirmation. So as I read more about the history, and I realized that Luther, disagreeing with James, tried to get the book, you know, basically removed from the canon of the New Testament. And then, you know, as if subtracting from Scripture wasn't bad enough, added the word "alone" to Romans 3:28, making it appear to back up his view. And I just found that so shocking, that if sola scriptura is true, if your authority truly is the Scripture, well, then how can you feel free to get rid of Scripture you don't like or change words around? And that just made me call into question the whole thing. I mean, if the progenitor of these ideas was that willing to mess with the very thing that he called an authority, you know, what does that say about everything else he did? You know, and is in his famous speech at Worms, he says that he has to be convinced by Scripture or plain reason. Well, it seems that at least in Luther's case, reason really trumps Scripture, in the sense that once he reasoned out what he thought was true, he was willing to modify both adding and subtracting to Scripture in order to get it to authoritatively teach what he taught. And, you know, I am completely aware, before you all call in, I am completely aware that Protestants have theological ways to explain James 2:24 so that it doesn't ultimately form a contradiction with the doctrine of sola fide, of justification by faith alone. But what I came to realize is that, you know, if you have a movement that can take a direct verbal contradiction in Scripture and rescue it with their theology, you've pretty much lost the authority to claim that anybody is misinterpreting Scripture in any other way. Certainly, if Scripture had verses in it that said Mary was not to be venerated, or that, you know, the successor of Peter was not in authority over the church, that would be on the cover of every Protestant book and church in the world. And yet, here we have a direct verbal contradiction with Scripture, with someone's primary theology that launched the entire movement, and nobody really seems to be too bothered by that. So I think that ultimately, ironically, it was sola fide that theologically, not practically, but theologically, made me realize that sola scriptura just wasn't the case.
Jesus?
Yes.
Does that make sense to you?
Oh, yes, yes, it does. It does. Thanks a lot, Doug. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you for your call. Again, our number, 888-318-7884. We're talking sola fide and sola scriptura, that is, the faith alone and Scripture alone, two tenets of the Lutheran branch of Protestantism right from the very beginning, with Doug Beaumont, former evangelical Protestant, now Catholic. Doug, that whole question of then, okay, so if the apparent contradiction there, or the difficulty in the letter of James, suggests to you that sola scriptura is not correct, then What ideas reinforce that idea for you? Like, for example, you mentioned at the break, for the, like the table of contents problem. What's the table of contents problem, and how does that reinforce what you're saying?
Yeah, that's a good question. Well, one thing that people need to remember is that when we talk about the solas, sola in Latin means alone. So you have these slogans that come out, sola fide, sola scriptura, sola Deo gratia, these sorts of things. But the sort of crass understanding that we're just making it the Bible alone or faith alone is always set against something specific from Catholic theology.
We'll have to take a break. Back. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have led you into a tough question with 30 seconds left. We'll take a quick break. It is Friday. Nobody's perfect. We'll be right back with more Douglas Beaumont on the topic of sola fide and sola scriptura right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
We're here for you. Give us a call today on Catholic Answers Live.
It might be said that anti-Catholic notions of the Church's history are the original fake news. With all the misinformation being spread, where does one look for the truth? In The Real Story of Catholic History, Professor Steve Weidenkopf gives you the facts on over 50 of the most common misconceptions about Catholic history and shows how to answer them simply and powerfully. Whether it's to answer claims about Catholicism's supposedly pagan origins, old myths about the Inquisition that never seem to go away, or more modern errors that anti-Catholics put forth, The Real Story of Catholic History is an essential resource for every Catholic's bookshelf. Order your copy of The Real Story of Catholic History today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
As the legend goes, the Protestant Reformation began when Martin Luther nailed a list of his grievances with the Catholic Church to the door of All Saints Church in Wittenberg, Germany. But do you know the whole story? In Catholic Answers' brand new documentary, The Protestant Revolution, you will hear from top apologists Tim Staples, Jimmy Akin, Carla Broussard, Trent Horn, and Steve Weidenkopf as they expose the errors of Martin Luther and of the other so-called reformers. This DVD will give you a clearer understanding of our Protestant brothers and sisters, and you will be better equipped to engage them about what separates us and about what unites us. Order your copy of The Protestant Revolution today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting shop.catholic.com, or by asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
EWTN, communicating the faith.
The best way to practice not really being able to fully celebrate in other people's successes is to go to what you're grateful for in your own life. So when someone next to you is having a great success, you immediately go to, Lord, I'm so grateful. I have my health. Well, I have my husband. I'm grateful. I have a roof over my head. And all of a sudden, everything becomes just perfect.
EWTN, live truth. Live Catholic.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. So happy you're here with us for a Friday afternoon or early evening, depending on, or maybe even late evening if you're listening in Europe. We're so happy to have you with us. 888-318-7884 is our number. We're talking maybe about the most contentious issue between Protestants and Catholics, or I probably shouldn't say it that way. The most contentious issue probably between Protestants and the rest of Christianity, because certainly this is not an idea that would find a home in Orthodoxy or Coptic Christianity or anywhere else. It's a Protestant idea, sola fide and sola scriptura. It came to us 500 years ago this year, and roughly 500 years ago this year, and Douglas Beaumont, who once lived by the creed of sola fide, sola scriptura, is now a Catholic, and his book is Evangelical Exodus, Evangelical Seminarians and Their Path to Rome. Lots of calls, but before we go to them, I only gave you like 10 seconds to answer a very complicated question. Didn't mean to do that to you, Doug, but my question was, it had to do with, you explained to Jesus how you kind of came to, the idea of Sola Scriptura came to be shattered for you, but I wanted to know, did you find other intellectual supports for it later? And particularly, I was asking you about the table of contents problem, if you could share your thoughts on that.
Yeah, sure. So going back to the solas, Sola Scriptura, anytime you hear one of the solas, you want to ask, what is this actually against? Because all of these are protests. Sola Scriptura is basically over against church tradition. So when someone is affirming the Bible alone, they're not necessarily taking the more Baptist fundamentalist view that the Bible is the only authority. They may just be making it the ultimate authority, especially over and against church tradition. So the difficulty is that if you've got, my evangelical background, I'm mostly talking from that, but if you've got an evangelical that's holding a Bible in their hands, what they've really got is a collection of books that have been deemed the Word of God. So again, when we went back and I said, you know, Sola Scriptura really just has a lot of intuitive sense. You've got these inspired books. Of course, they're going to be the top authority. The trouble is, somebody had to figure out which books were inspired. And so by the very fact that an evangelical or a Protestant has a standard 27-book New Testament Bible, they've already accepted the most important tradition of all, namely that these are the inspired books and these others, while valuable, are not. So it's an interesting issue that I personally didn't think about very much until I was doing doctoral studies, believe it or not, that the Bible itself needs to be accounted for as a collection of books. And so if the Bible doesn't give its own table of contents, well, then you've already accepted the authority of the church just by virtue of the fact that you have these 27 books and not some other.
888-318-7884, our number. So I said we had a lot of calls, so maybe we should get to those. We go now to Aaron in Pueblo, Colorado. Aaron, you are on with Douglas Beaumont. Your question, please.
Hello, Doug. How are you doing?
Doing well.
One of my I'm not a Protestant. Or no, I am a Protestant. I'm not Catholic. But one of my favorite priests has explained Sola Fide in a way that I believe is very similar to a lot of evangelical beliefs, like you touched on earlier. And you correct me if I explain this wrongly, but what he said, it appeared, is that we are saved, you know, sola gratia. And we could even say sola fide, so long as we understand what we mean by faith in a James sense, that a faith of necessity produces good works, a genuine faith. So we could say that so long as we understand that faith does produce those works. And that's very a phrase or a formulation that I've heard in evangelicalism a lot as a way of explaining James. So if that is... if I presented that rightly as a good Catholic view, what then is still the difference that divides us?
That's a great question, Aaron. And first of all, I want to commend you for recognizing that salvation is sola gratia. You know, the main verse that most Protestants will trot out for sola fide is Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, which actually begins by saying that we are saved by God's grace. So the word by there, saved by, what are we saved by? I used to ask my students this in class just to be funny. You know, how many of you believe that we are saved by faith? And then I'd have them turn to Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, which they all knew. And then we'd read it, and oh, look at that, we're actually saved by grace. Isn't that interesting? And so the wording there, the causality implied by these words is very interesting. We're actually saved by grace, which Protestants that understand what that means and Catholics agree on. We're saved through faith, according to Ephesians 2:8. So the question then becomes, okay, but that word faith can have a lot of meaning to it, and Protestants recognize this as well. And so what ends up happening is that we take this very simple word in Scripture and we sort of pour our theological meaning into it. And so, for example, when James says that, you know, faith alone does not save, he compares it to what? To demons, right? He says demons believe and they shudder. So obviously there's some sense in which faith can't save. But then you go back to Romans 3, and even without Luther sneaking the word alone in there, he does seem to almost contradict James by his words, saying that we are justified by faith. And what's ironic is that James and Paul both use Abraham as examples for the statements they're making. So what is this about? And so, you know, I don't know how much you've studied this in your tradition, but I know that, you know, there's a Lutheran version of what faith is. There's a Reformed version of what faith is. There's a free grace version of what faith is. What I would say is this, that what the Catholic is affirming is that, as Paul says, that there is such a thing as a faith working through love. You go to 1 Corinthians 13, we have faith, hope, and love. And so those virtues, those theological virtues, are united in someone who is saved. In other words, they're all present. So you don't have hope separate from charity or love. You don't have faith separated from those. If you want to just roll up faith, hope, and love into the word faith, well, then sure, it's sola fide at that point. Because now we're talking about a faith that includes faith, which is just kind of the demonic, you know, the assent to a truth. But then you also have hope, which the demons don't have. You also have love or charity, which the demons don't have. And if you read over in Galatians, Paul describes specifically the kind of faith that justifies and saves as faith working through love. And so really what the Catholic Church is doing is they're trying to take all of this data and put it together and say, that's what we're talking about when we talk about faith. And so what Trent anathematized was the idea that faith could be taken out of the context of hope and charity and works working through love and still save. And that's what they said can't be done. So it's not, I wouldn't say that simply defining faith as one that has a fruit of works, that's not necessarily sufficient, because then you could get into legalism, right? You could have the faith of a demon and then go do some good stuff, okay? Maybe because you're just afraid of hell or something. Well, that's still not biblical faith from the Catholic view. But if you have the kind of faith that is faith, hope, and love, and it works through love, and that's where the works come in, and that's how they come in, well, then, yeah, we're back to being on the same page, and we can, you know, go get a beer. Unless you're Baptist.
I was just going to say that. You beat me to it. Aaron, how does all that strike you?
Yeah, that sounds good. Like, I really do think that I would subscribe to a Catholic view of faith and salvation in that sense.
So you were right when you started by saying, I'm not a Protestant at the beginning. Remember when you said that? It turns out you were right.
Welcome home, buddy.
Freud got me again.
Well, Aaron, thank you. Thanks very much for that call. We really do appreciate it, Aaron. We're talking Sola Scriptura, Sola Fide with our, Douglas Beaumont, who once lived under that creed and now lives under the creed of the Catholic Church. We go now to Carol in Westminster, Colorado. You are on with Dr. Beaumont. Your question, please.
I have two. The first one is, I was talking to a friend of mine who's a Baptist. And he said, once saved, always saved. And I don't believe that. I don't know where that is in the Bible. And the second one was, and then he was telling me that it was all about interpretation. And then I said to him, well, you know, in the back of the Bible, the very last little message that it says in Revelation, you know, if you take away from any of the words in here or you add to them, it's not a good thing. I don't know the exact.
A little stricter than that, but yeah, that's a good paraphrase. Yeah. So, first of all, let's start with once saved, always saved. Doug, where is that in the Bible?
Well, you know, you won't find that phrase anywhere in Scripture. Rather, this is an idea that is really kind of the end of a long equation of a particular brand of theology known as Calvinism, which, and this is one of the other solas. In attempting to give glory only to God, sola Deo gratia, the Calvinist type, even if they're not necessarily Reformed, wants to remove the human element as much as possible from salvation. We want to give all the glory to God for our salvation. And what that means is that we don't want to have very much on the human side of free will or anything like that being mixed into that, because then it seems like it's taking glory from God and giving it to man. So this is a massive oversimplification, but at the end of the day, if God ends up being the prime mover and the one who is ultimately truly responsible for saving somebody, then to say that you could lose your salvation because of something you do makes it sound like you are more powerful than God. You can actually undo something that God did, or that perhaps God failed. You know, Jesus died for your sins, but then you did something bad, and so you're not saved anymore, and now his blood is wasted, or these sorts of things. So ultimately, once saved, always saved, is trying to give glory to God by making him the author of salvation with very little human input. What he saves can't be lost, and therefore, if you are indeed saved, you are always saved. There's no way to lose your salvation. So once saved, always saved is really just a slogan that is based on an entire wing of Protestant theology that I would say the majority of Protestants do not hold to, but it is certainly one of the more popular among scholars and academics. When you get down to the more evangelical Baptist level, it's usually a little more simple than that, but the end of the equation is the same for both groups. The idea that if you've ever put your faith in Christ, you are saved, and that can never be lost.
Oh, I was going to go back to Carol, but let me see. Carol, how does that strike you?
Does that mean you can't lose your salvation?
The phrase is indicating that you cannot lose your salvation. Now, that's not what the church teaches, but that is what a Calvinistic type Christian believes.
Okay, so then you can lose your salvation.
Yes. Yes.
And that's through sin.
There's no other way. How else are you going to lose your salvation?
I mean, according to the church, it would require a very volitional, willful act, something that is gravely sinful and evil. A person has to know that it's gravely sinful and evil and do it anyway. And basically the idea is that if you're going to get to that point where you're just kind of ready to, you know, tell God off and I'm just going to do this horrendous thing, he's going to let you. And there's no reason to suspect that the grace that he gave you is going to remain in your life. Now, confession is available and repentance and that state of grace, we call it, that perhaps the Protestant would refer to as being saved, can return. But the church does teach that it is possible to fall from grace, and that is how it's done. It's through a massively evil act that someone does on purpose with full knowledge.
Carol, I have to say thank you for that call because we have to take a break. We'll be right back with more Douglas Beaumont and our discussion of Sola Fide, Sola Scriptura when we come back after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Your questions, Catholic Answers Live.
Did the Catholic Church add books to the Bible, or did Protestants remove seven books from the Old Testament? The very makeup of God's holy word hangs in the balance. Do you know the answer? In the newly revised version of his book, Why Catholic Bibles Are Bigger, author Gary Machuda takes you on a fact-filled tour through the history of the Bible, revealing the whole story behind the lost books of the Protestant Old Testament. With updated information, expanded discourse on crucial issues, and a new topical index, Why Catholic Bibles Are Bigger is a book that belongs in the library of every serious student of Scripture. Order your copy of Why Catholic Bibles Are Bigger today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
The Catholic Answers Minute. I'm Father Vincent Serpa. In Luke 14, Jesus dined at the home of a leading Pharisee. Noticing a man with dropsy, Jesus healed him, much to the disdain of the scholars of the law. So he asked them, "Who among you, if your son or ox falls into a cistern, would not immediately pull him out on the Sabbath?" But they were unable to answer his question. The Pharisees and scholars didn't want to acknowledge that Jesus was correct. By showing such charity, he was fulfilling the Sabbath far better than they were with their obsession with keeping external observance of the law only. In itself, showing compassion for those in need is never at odds with our love for God. But ignoring such persons is. The Lord identifies with such people, just as he does with the thousands of innocent babies whose lives are taken through abortion. We need to show compassion for these little ones of his in every way, not the least of which is the way we vote. I'm Father Vincent Serpa for Catholic Answers, Catholic.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Douglas Beaumont, the author of Evangelical Exodus, Evangelical Seminarians and Their Paths to Rome, is our guest. We are talking about the teaching of that salvation comes through faith alone, and that we are that the only authority over us is Scripture, and that those are expressed in two Latin phrases, sola fide and sola scriptura. Lots and lots of questions, and I don't want to miss anybody, so let's go to Warren in Alexandria, Indiana, listening on EWTN. Warren, your question for Douglas Beaumont.
Hey, good evening, and thanks for taking the call. Hey, my question is this. If sola scriptura is not, or sola scriptura is not the only thing that we would use, so the Bible, and I really love the way you said this earlier, that if two things butt head, the Bible gets the push, but if that is not the only thing, then how can we determine if it's not God-ordained or man-ordained, what other documents and what other material can we rely on if it's not inspired by God? Because we don't want to get tied into what you had discussed with Martin Luther. He was able to take a word or leave a word. So how do we know what is God wants us to know other than the Bible?
Okay, Doug?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. And honestly, Warren, I mean, the way you phrased that was a lot of the driving force behind my journey. You know, as an apologist, as a trained defender of the faith, so to speak, you know, I was charged with defending the faith once delivered to the saints, as it says in Jude. And the difficulty that I had as an evangelical was, well, you know, which one of these 30 systematic theologies behind me am I defending? And then, you know, we would typically say, well, you know, we can just look at the essentials, you know, the mere Christianity that we all agree on. Well, but you always end up only picking the groups that already share those essentials with you, right? Like, I wouldn't worry about what a Jehovah's Witness thought, although I might be concerned with what a Presbyterian thought. But where in the Bible, back to sola scriptura again, where in the Bible does it say this is an essential doctrine and this is a non-essential doctrine? And you can go on my website to see where all of the answers that I tried failed. But to answer your question just in the positive, we can do it in the way that the church has always done it. We can start in Scripture itself. Look all the way back at Acts 15. When this question comes up about Jewish legalism, the apostles got together with the other leaders of the church, and they had a discussion, and they formally hammered out a response to the question, and they sent that out to the churches. And that was really what I consider the first ecumenical council, if you will, the council at Jerusalem. Well, the church didn't stop doing that. You know, you have Nicaea in AD 325 and on and on and on to this very day. The church continues to meet in these councils. We have a magisterium. We have the bishops of the church who, when they are in union with the Pope, so that we know, you know, we know that bishops sometimes go off into heresy. And so, you know, then what do you do? Which bishop do you follow if two bishops disagree with one another? The Catholic has an answer, and that is that the apostolic chair, if you will, of Peter in Rome is guarded from making these kinds of mistakes. And so when the leadership of the church that God put in place, that we can identify historically through apostolic succession, okay, so there's no subjectivism there. We can just look at history and see who these guys are. When they declare something to be dogma, well, then that's something that has to be believed. And so that we put that right up with the table of contents of the Bible, the Trinity, the dual natures of Christ, and these other things that other councils and the magisterium have decreed. Now, as far as where those teachings end up practically, you can look at the Catechism of the Catholic Church for what it teaches. Not necessarily every single thing in there has been decreed infallibly. If you really want to try to see a list that actually puts like a stamp on the various dogmas, you can look at Ludwig Ott's book, Fundamentals of Catholic Dogma. I'm looking at it because it's sitting right there, where he actually goes through the various theologies and positions of the church and sort of labels them as to their level of dogma. But honestly, it's a lived faith. I mean, there's a sense in which you turn to the church to find out the answer to a lot of questions, and the church hasn't ruled on several things. And if it hasn't, then you're free to hold different opinions, and eventually, if you go too far, the church will let you know. So that's the way it's basically worked out over the last 2,000 years.
Does that address your question?
Well, it certainly gives me more to think about. I'm certainly not on the same journey that the doctor is, but I did pastor in a Protestant church for 8 years, and now I am on this brand new journey with Catholicism, and there are a lot of questions and all these things that we're trying to come to grips with. But the beauty of it is, what I've seen in Mass is Christ is absolutely the center, and there's where worship, I believe, should begin. And so we think we're on the right track, but I'll be looking forward to reading your book and looking on your website.
Appreciate it. Amen.
Thank you so much. What a gracious call. Very, very happy to that's okay. Can we just close the show now? That was a great ender. No, we can't. All right. Well, it's probably good we got some more time because we got some more calls. Luke in, I'm going to say Pulsan, but I don't know if that's the name of your town, listening on Divine Mercy Radio. Did I say the town right? Pulsan?
It's Polson, Montana.
I have a misspelling here, I think. Okay, sorry. Luke, your question for Douglas.
Yeah, well, you know, I've been in these conversations with a Protestant friend, family, and even Protestant relative strangers who are on, like, Facebook and stuff about the authoritative teachings of the church and the origins of the Catholic Church, and I keep running up against this same wall where, you know, they just want to bang that drum of sola fide and sola scriptura, until not only they're blue in the face, but I am almost exasperated by, you know, repeating myself about, like, Matthew, you know, 18, you know, about Jesus giving Peter the authority, James, you know, chapter 2, obviously, and also a lot of John's gospel, like John 6, 53, about the Eucharist, you know, very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you shall have no life within you. And I got to tell you, my heart goes out to these people because, as a Catholic, you know, we know that, like Padre Pio said, the earth could easier survive without the sun than the Holy Eucharist. And so my question is, I'm looking for reading resources for myself and also things that I can tell them.
Okay, let's
about
let,
the origin.
Just because we're short of time, I'm just going to, your question's clear, so let's let Doug address it so we don't run out of time. Go ahead, Doug.
Yeah, that's always so hard because, you know, it would be great if there was just a silver bullet, you know, and just that one perfect book or that one perfect website. It's always a personal journey. You never know which one of these arguments or facts or something they're going to notice and really, you know, make that thing click in their mind. But what I would say is, overall, this is always an issue of authority. We can go back and forth with theologies forever, as you know. but at the end of the day, what really is going to change someone's mind is what is the authority for this faith that we have. And so personally, I would study more about that. Christian Smith has a great book with a long title. I think it's called How to Go from Being a Good Evangelical to a Committed Catholic in 95 Difficult Steps, or something like that. But it's a great little book that explains conversion. And one of the things he points out is that the first step in a worldview change is some kind of dissatisfaction with the worldview that you're already in. So one thing that I really appreciate about, so here's a resource, Devin Rose's book, The Protestant's Dilemma. Devin was very instrumental in my conversion. He's a good friend. But he would ask me these questions that I had a hard time answering. And I think that that is really what led me to open my mind to all of the arguments that the church was given. And until that happens, it's going to be very difficult to convince somebody that their interpretation is wrong. So I looked at a lot of things like, you know, why isn't sola scriptura stated in the Bible? How does sola scriptura interpret the table of contents? All of these kinds of things that we just know Protestants really can't answer very well. So I would maybe start with Protestant's Dilemma. I would look at some other conversion books to see how others came into the church, and then just go to the sources and make sure you're ready with an answer when they ask.
Luke, thanks very much for that call. And I suppose if I would add one thing, it's convince them that you're not trying to lead them away from Christ, but closer to Christ, more Christ, not never less Christ. Douglas Beaumont, author of Evangelical Exodus, Evangelical Seminarians and Their Paths to Rome. Thanks so much for a really pleasant hour.
Great being on. Thanks a lot.
I hope we'll do this again.
Absolutely.
Thanks to all our listeners. Thanks, Nick, for running the sound. Thanks, Kathleen, for running the video. And thanks, Nathan, for... Oh, you're on your... Okay, running the phones. Jesus Christ is the light of the nations. We'll see you next time on Catholic Answers Live.